these guys are really going to show a lot of the more interesting stuff. So, first thing, I did not, none of us named this session.
But we really liked it.
But all of us really liked it.
Yeah.
That's really cool. I think it was Josh Stearns from Free Press who decided this would be a great title.
Yeah. We're not going to talk about Bill O'Reilly. Not really going to talk about satellite trucks, obviously, although we're still plenty of them running around on the streets. My view, and it's David, right?
Daniel.
Yeah,
sorry.
Daniel in the back is actually from live stream.
Live view.
Live view, I'm sorry.
Sorry, it's all the name of the two computers.
They're all the same thing with a U and a live in the stream.
Yes. Okay. Live view. And I got it right on the slide. Anyway, this is sort of the one of the next steps, and maybe I'll get to talk about that a little bit later. And let's see. I had the price that I had just put down on here, which I grabbed from your website, was including the equipment as well as the service charge, because there's a significant service charge in using something like this as a replacement to a satellite truck. But anyway, we wanted to talk more about what you can do with very small, inexpensive things. So I'm just going to show you a couple of really quick video clips to just give you an idea of what you can do.
You can use the mic, maybe?
He can't hear you. Oh, sorry. Maybe I'll just sit down and talk to the mic. Okay. This one is just a really simple video. It's actually not live streamed. It was a Chicago Tribune reporter who went into this the middle of this NATO protest in, I think it was in Chicago, and so it's not live. He just has had a GoPro like strapped to his chest. Let's see. And what happened to my sound? Is there a volume maybe in somewhere? Anyway, just to sort of give you an idea of the types of things and where you can go without having a large unit. Even the live view thing that I just showed you is still, it's going to get jostled around if you're in a riot or protest, whereas if you have something like a fairly sturdy GoPro, maybe on a chest strap or maybe on a helmet or something like that, can be pretty useful. I was going to show you one other quick thing. This is actually, again, not live. This is a really interesting technique, I think, and perhaps Tim could talk about later about the possibility of turning this into live streaming. There's a really great photojournalist named Amanda Mustard. She's based out of Cairo, and incredible photographer. Really admire her work. She also has started shooting a lot of assignments, especially say riots in the Middle East, that sort of thing, where she'll mount a GoPro on top of her DSLR, and I'll just show you a tiny bit of this. And basically what you see is she is video recording her assignment, and then,
we can sound. Someone's screaming next to her.
Yeah.
Let's see if it's loading.
If my connection is not going to work, I'll just have to describe it. But essentially, what she produces is a sort of video walkthrough of her assignment covering this riot. And then you can actually see her, sort of the bottom part of her lens on the bottom of the GoPro video image. And then, you'll hear her clicking throughout the thing. And then she puts up her best pictures that she took during the assignment. And really kind of an interesting, innovative way of covering something. But the interesting point, I think, is simply that we should be able to fairly soon be able to have photojournalists in, you know, in live contact with, say, with their editors, or perhaps live streaming directly from an assignment like this, you know, depending on what kind of bandwidth they have. So what we were hoping to talk about was the very, very low cost stuff. And there's been a lot of new developments in technology. One of the smaller ones is this thing called a Looksee. Daniel, do you have that? When these first came out a couple of years ago, they would simply you hang it on your ear, and it will continuously record what you're experiencing. So last year at a protest up at the University of Colorado, we had a bunch of students covering that, and one of them used one of the older Looksees just to record the things as they were going, as he was going around campus. And then a nice little feature of it is if you can push a button, and then it'll take the last 30 seconds and then be able to send that back to, say, your editor. The newer ones that came out, the Looksee HD, can actually live stream. And it's hooked up, apparently, to Wi-Fi to your phone, whereas the older ones were a Bluetooth connection.
Does it hook on to a Wi-Fi? Your phone's hooked to a Wi-Fi now. Does it hook through like your phone? Does its own Wi-Fi?
Yeah, there's a Wi-Fi network that these connect to, and then if we're broadcasting out, you would use your cell.
So you could use your phone as the way to output, you know, okay quality video, or some of the other stuff that we'll talk about pretty soon could perhaps be in addition to it. One really interesting example of using this is, since they're not that expensive, let's say you have a newsroom and your reporters are out covering a major event, and if you can imagine them all wearing that, it would give you the opportunity as an editor back in the office to actually see through their eyes and you know, kind of help direct the coverage. So there's actually a promotional video on the Looksee site. I'm just going to direct you to it, so that I don't take up too much time, but it talks about this this idea, and the promotional video is a guy puts on one of these things on his hat, and he's going out on a mountain biking trip, and he stops, launches his application, sends a message to his wife, and his wife is looking in on his mountain bike ride from her kitchen. So you can sort of imagine that for some other uses like journalism, starts to get pretty interesting and pretty inexpensive. No need for me to talk much about this, but yeah, you know, we can obviously live stream just simply from the more modern iPhone and Androids and some of the tablets. And again, look, these guys mostly talk about it. There are a number of apps and services. It's CU, our students, we've been playing around with Ustream and Livestream. Mostly, we you know, you can get free accounts on something like Ustream. We just have an account that we pay so much a month for, and then to allow our students to be able to live stream different events and experiment with it. And if you're going to use a phone, it's a great idea to enhance it, because if you're trying to do video with just holding your phone, it's not going to be very stable. So I know Daniel's going to show you one thing that is called an M-cam, and
yeah, I'll show that.
And we have some other equipment to both stabilize the image when you're shooting video, as well as add additional things like additional lenses, add an additional, better microphone, and then and you can do the same sort of thing with iPod Mini. There's a Kickstarter campaign. Somebody's trying to create some hardware for an iPad mini to be able to turn it into a mobile video media station. And then, of course, GoPros. You know, athletes have been using these for years. We're trying to figure out, you know, better ways to live stream with them. And Daniel and Ashley worked with some students, I guess, last semester, where one of the students was going to do her first ever skydive. So a couple of the other, her colleagues decided, this would be a good experiment to see if we can live stream from the GoPro. So we loaded her up with GoPro and a couple of other devices, which Daniel will show in a minute, and we're able to actually live stream her doing her first parachute jump. So, and Tim, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe the GoPro app, we're still waiting for that, for us to be able to live stream from that app.
And there's supposed to be a Wi-Fi adapter that would allow you to connect to Wi-Fi directly to the GoPro, but for whatever reason was delayed and hasn't come out yet. So I think the main way to do it now is to hook it up through HDMI to a live video encoder.
Yeah, and that's what we've done in our experiments. But hopefully that's coming very soon. It'll be a lot easier to live stream from a GoPro. This is sort of a novelty thing, and I didn't even get a chance to ask, did you actually get that to work?
Not yet.
Close. Oh, okay. It's sort of a novelty thing called a GoPro and a GoPanel. GoPanel. And you can have one. You can buy one for the iPhone. I don't think they have it for Android. And also, you can get one that you can just put on most any old camera or DSLR. And it is essentially just creates 360-degree interactive video. Are we going to be able to demo that?
The website.
Well, I could, because there's a video that I could show.
Oh, the video, yeah. Show the video.
Yeah, just so you understand what I'm talking about. This was a promotional thing by the GoPanel folks. You'll see what I mean by 360-degree interactive video. This is obviously recorded. Nothing to do with live streaming. But we think should be pretty close to being able to live stream 360-degree interactive video. And let's hope it loads. All right, I'm gonna have to describe this. So let's pretend that the internet connection here. No, let's pretend the internet connection.
Refresh the whole browser page.
Try a different one. Okay. The idea is if I got this thing loaded, you would see what looked like a typical YouTube video. This is one of the band playing a song. Okay, let's try again. okay, this is gonna work.
Well, maybe try like aiming.
Okay. Just pretend that this is working perfectly like it should. And what I should be able to do is look around. There we go.
So you're able to pan within the video. And the device that he's talking about, there's two versions. There's one for a DSLR, which is $300 to $600. And this is for an iPhone or iPod. They give you a case like this, and it just mounts to the back of it. And then what it does, there's a mirror inside of it, so the iPhone camera actually just records whatever in front of it. In this case, it's a little periscope, and so you can see the mirror. And it'll record 360 degrees around.
Using the built-in camera.
Using the built-in.
The built-in camera on the iPhone, yeah.
Is that compatible with most live stream softwares?
No. No. Not at this point. They have a, there's an app for the iPhone. I don't, last time I looked, they didn't have it for Android. And if you use this, the other one that you put on a camera, you would, you just get a video that's really wide that you wouldn't be able to pan, but you'd still see this. What a 360 degrees video looking like this.
What the lens does is it turns the image into what essentially a donut with a black hole in the middle. The software then basically takes, it's a rectangle to straight protocol or algorithm that converts into a straight band that you can rotate around. So in order to actually get 360 degrees, you need a back end or a user front end that can basically pan through it and convert this image. So right now that's not available, but yeah, hopefully soon.
Hopefully we'll have that soon. Yeah. And I'm already going along, so I'll skip this because Daniel's going to get it. This is some equipment that we've been using to live stream from various cameras, any camera that has an HDMI output. And the other thing that's likely to come up is using low-cost drones.
I have a video on the time that we can play later.
Oh, that'd be perfect. That'd be perfect. And one last thing I just wanted to mention, this is a trend that I talk a lot about with students at CU, is that you guys probably all remember this New York Post photo of the guy about to die under the railroad in the subway. So we're getting to the point now where it's pretty darn easy to turn on your phone and start live streaming. Probably a journalist is not going to want to do that, not want to show this. This workshop was also said to be for sort of citizen journalists or for anybody who wanted to use this technology. And I think probably in the next year or so we're going to start to see stuff like this. Probably this very horrific scene of, say, this guy dying. If this happened a couple years from now, you very well could find it coming across your Facebook feed, which is kind of an interesting and scary thought. And so I'm done, other than just to show this. This was a PBS. They hooked up some of their correspondents at the conventions last time. And this is a GoPro, looks like she's got a boom mic, and Tom, can you kind of tell what she's got on her back?
That embarrasses me.
That's cool, man.
That's not the outfit you wear.
No.
All right, so I'm gonna show off some cool toys, or tools, we've been using at CU. I also brought some, we're from CU, University of Colorado, journalism program. So I brought some brochures about how we're innovating and changing things up. So feel free to take one of those. First up is, I'm gonna show this puppy in just a second. Keep that right there. So we've been using these things called MCAMs or OWLs. What it is a metal case that has an iPod. It's basically a really nice iPod case or an iPhone case that you can just pop in. Comes with a little 360 degree little mic so you can talk and record audio. It comes with a lens that is not this whole thing. The lens is this first part here, which you can probably see a little bit better in this. It's just a little wide angle lens. And then this next part is a SLR adapter. So you can take any SLR, Nikon or Canon, hook it on here, and do manual focus and exposure. So you can zoom in and stuff like that. So you can really take advantage of your iPhone or iPod. There's all kinds of shoes and mounts for, there's screws for screwing tripods or whatever attachments you got. This one, we have a light, an LED light Other things that you can screw in are like a live stream box, if you're using an iPod, or, you know, these are nice little tripod mounts. We use this to, last year for the 420 protests, you know, the campus CU closed their campus to 420. So we actually had a student walking around with one of this live streaming, and I had in my pocket, because other students were covering the protests, I had one of these MiFi hotspots. So this is probably my best entry on my resume. I was a mobile hotspot for a day. It was really cool. The iPod connected to the mobile hotspot in my pocket, I had a little antenna. She could walk around and live stream the whole thing. What we discovered is that the sort of the rules or the guidelines of broadcast journalism still apply. So she was doing a great job live streaming, but she wasn't telling her audience what was happening. So she would stop live streaming because her arm was heavy. Because this thing can get kind of heavy. And her audience, these are people with a daily camera, was it a glitch? What happened? And then she fired back up, you know, a few minutes later, without explaining why. So there's still a lot to be done with this. My new friend Daniel over there in the back from LiveView just shared the latest.
That's not the latest. That's just actually available. Must have been the latest.
The currently available. And this one's a little bit lighter, it feels like. It's made out of
resin. So the same company that made these things, Audi, they then sold themselves to somebody else and renamed it Focus with a PH. And Jay, actually, this guy here is the one who told me about it in the first place because he's been using them out in Maui. So now with their little one, you can actually just slide your phone in. And that one, you have to put it in a case that snaps in. And they figured out also to give you cabling to hook up an external mic because it blocks the iPhone 5's microphone. So if you don't use an external mic with their little setup, you don't hear things real well. Yeah. But then they also sell this little Steadicam and a pistol grip.
What's the name of it?
Focus. Focus. They're out of Arizona. They're not too badly priced, like $100 for the case and $40 for this and $80 for the mic. But if you're trying to make a whole fancy little rig out of your phone, it's nice hardware.
Yeah, this is excellent. So afterwards, check this out.
The case is Focus as well?
Yeah, the case is Focus. So Focus makes the case that you stick your phone in. And they're not doing live streaming, they're just giving you a case. I bought all this so I could show off our live streaming product on it, but my company's gonna show next week at NAB something that kind of does this. That holds the hotspot is actually built into it, as is battery. So you could live stream. It's a monopod that you hold through your phone with, but it gives your phone enough battery life to broadcast for like 8 hours. And if you've got a Verizon phone and an AT&T hotspot built into it, everywhere you go, you're broadcasting at really high rates, and you don't drop off. So that's why I'm giving this thing away, because I don't need it.
Purchase directly from Focus or?
Yeah, go to their website. It's smartfocus.com.
So, do you have a model number or something?
They only have a couple products, just okay. Look on their website. I'm not pimping for them. I bought their thing and now I don't need to buy it anymore because I have better stuff. But I'll sell this used if anybody really wants it. I'll give it to you for cash.
Excellent, thank you, Daniel.
Sorry.
So,
I might be interested.
Yeah, the next stuff, so Steve talked about this really briefly. We use this up at CU, it's called the Livestream Broadcaster. They just came out last summer with this. Basically, you can take any HDMI source and live stream it up using their live stream service. It's got different plugs. It takes 3 AA batteries. And then they have to be something we discovered. They have to be not the rechargeable. So it has to be 1.5 volt, if you will. And it can connect to, yeah.
Could you please explain HDMI for folks who don't know what that is yet?
Yeah, so the old school way of connecting audio and video were through analog cables, a little RCA cable. I don't have any in front of me, but you know, the phono jacks you would see for your TV, back of the TV. So the newer standard is called HDMI, where everything's wrapped together, audio and video, into one connection.
So is that a wireless transmitter, or
do
we see
that?
It's a cable.
It's just, HDMI is just a cable.
Where you plug into your TV from your DVR.
Yeah, DVR,
Blu-ray.
So that's
going to
work
with
HDMI output.
Yeah, and that's really important. If you have an HDMI output on your camera, like we have a GoPro over here, and that has a HDMI mini or micro HDMI connection here. This can plug into this.
This is an HDMI cable.
Thanks. But that's really good because we do, you know, we're in university and we have older cameras for some projects, and but our newer broadcast cameras are all HDMI. Most of the standards, that's what they're moving to. So so this has a little Wi-Fi chip in it so that it can connect to this MiFi unit. So when our CU Independent, that's our student new online news website, when they wanted to do a story on skydiving in Boulder, they took both of these along with a GoPro, strapped it to an instructor who was strapped to the student, and they jumped out of the airplane. It's probably one of the coolest uses of this. So that, definitely check it out. There are some downsides to it. It has a little bit of a delay, so we found about a 17-second delay, regardless of what network or what we're doing, which could actually be an advantage to you. But just
so for live shots, it's not gonna.
It does live shots. It just has a delay from when it's broadcasting to what it's actually capturing.
Real fast. We mentioned DSLR. This is Sony NEX7, so it's not especially expensive camera. A little over $1,000, I think, for the body. Though it does have HDMI, and a lot of the more modern cameras, unless you buy a very inexpensive one, do have HDMI out now. So you'd be able to use the HDMI box for something like this.
Yep. Excellent. So I have some more toys and things to show off. Tools. This is the GoPro. You guys are probably familiar with this. If not, these are really kind of everywhere now, ubiquitous. This is the latest one, only the best for our students, so Hero 3. And it comes in, it has a fisheye wide-angle lens and different backs, like batteries and stuff that you can connect to this. Remotes, it's supposed to eventually connect to your smartphone or something, eventually. They come in really protective cases, like this. I mean, this is plastic. I mean, this would be really hard to break. There's all kind. When you buy it, you can get the full kit, and this is one part of the full kit. Or it's called the chest mount. So you actually strap this to your chest, and it will connect to the GoPro. This is for a head mount. Put this on your head, maybe for skydiving or something like that. There's all kinds of mounts, tripod mounts, pretty much any kind of mount that you could think of. Someone else has already thought of. This is a little remote that allows you to record. There is a smartphone app that allows you to do the same thing. So let's see.
So
I've spent the past year and a half in around the world in various protests and riots, conflicts, and conventions, sometimes they're home. And I've had a chance to use a lot of this stuff in areas where you need to be quick about things, you know. An example of the shift in where live broadcasting is headed. I was in Chicago for the NATO protests, and all of the local news outlets are driving their big satellite trucks trying to keep up with the protests. And they couldn't carry these massive cameras with these big cables. And for my friend in the back, they couldn't even carry the big backpacks, which, you know, could weigh up to 30 pounds, 20 or 30 pounds. And we had folks like this gentleman sitting in the front who has a smartphone plugged into a battery, keeping pace with the march the entire time. So in my travels and experiments, I've done a bunch of wacky things, like flying drones and trying out new tools. But the best way to explain it to everybody is look at the back of the room with what everyone's doing. They're holding up their cell phones. So pretty much everyone here already has a camera with radios that connect to powerful internet connections. If you have 4G of any kind, you're going to be getting tech on you. You're going to easily get over 1 megabit. So if you want to do a high definition broadcast, you want between 1.5 and 2.5. Now, all of the devices I have here, I only use mobile devices. So I've got Galaxy S3, it's an Android device, I've got the Galaxy S2, I've got the iPhone 5. They're all capable of reaching high definition quality. So using different services, which I will get into now, there's the two big ones are Ustream and Livestream. They have their pros and their cons. So for those that are looking to get into low-cost web and live streaming, et cetera, Ustream, for their mobile, they shoot in 4x3, and they can do about, with a mobile device, you can get high definition, but when you're relying on one cellular connection, there's a down. I've used Ustream for most of my work throughout the past year, and only recently started using Livestream, but that's mostly because Livestream has given me a professional access and, you know, all the sweet features. For everybody that, you know, wants to start streaming live and you're doing it with almost no budget, you can sign up for Livestream, you can use your existing mobile device. The quality, depending on the network you have or the bandwidth they allow you to get, will be maybe just below standard definition, you know, not necessarily broadcast quality. But it's free and it's fast. You know, one of the drawbacks is they'll run ads on your video, so that might interrupt live breaking news. You could be filming this, and right when I'm about to reveal the big secret, it cuts to a commercial. As for live stream, the quality is a lot better. They do have updated apps with filters like night vision and some, you know, sepia and other things that, you know, aren't necessarily as useful as night vision. But it shoots in 16:9. It's a better quality, and it can run on Android or the iPhone. However, unless you pay for a premium service, the only way people can watch it is if they sign up for the service and watch on the website. So the main reason I, you know, when I go for a live video encoder, I go for an open RTMP device, is because, you know, the live stream box, like I said, proprietary. And unless you're dedicated to hosting all of your content on their website, not your own, or paying for premium service, you're locked into that.
Do they have to pay to sign up?
It's free to sign up for live stream for everybody. So if you are doing a broadcast and your viewers want to watch, they have to sign up, but it is true. We've always set them up with Android devices, brand new Android devices, no personal information. It's running a custom operating system called Cyanogen 9. I'm using a tool that you should all be familiar with called Tor, or the Onion Relay.
Yep.
This is an anonymizer, so if you're a journalist, and again, you might not be in the most dangerous field, but this makes sure that if anyone is tracking your information, they can't figure out where you are physically located. I also have a GPS obfuscating app that will make it appear as though I'm a few blocks away from where I actually am. So for me personally, I know this isn't for everybody, but I do protests, I've done riots, and I've been in situations where I have been tracked by police, and I have sources in the police departments who have confirmed this with me. So it's important to make sure that,
can't they just track you by looking at your video though?
Yes, but here's the thing.
They never try that. They have a wiretap before they go to live stream.
You know where he's at? Like, he's been live for 4 hours. What do you mean?
Yes.
But,
technically, but not necessarily. So, I usually will go with the iPhone when I'm in something that's overtly public, because they can know where I am when I'm streaming. But when it comes to journalism in general, you're not necessarily going to be streaming when you're posting information. Or you're not necessarily going to be showing identifying features of exactly where you're at. They can look at my stream and know that I'm somewhere in New York, and when they look to my GPS, it shows that I'm on 34th and, you know, Lexington, when I'm actually on, you know, 32nd in Lexington. So when whoever is tracking me goes down there, they go to the wrong place.
Is that a commonly available app?
Yeah, there's a Tor, but you have to be running a custom operating system or have a rooted device. So, you know, basically this is a bit, you know, different, but in terms of technology, I can't stress this enough. Journalists need to be aware of mobile technology, computers, and security, because it's if you're using if you don't know anything about it, then rest assured, if you're working on any story that might make someone angry, and you probably are, they're reading every email you send, they're following, you're being tracked on social media, they're watching you, and if someone doesn't like what you're doing, they're going to find a way to discredit you. And even more dangerous things. So there have been, like I said before, I've been physically attacked. People have followed me. There's NBC did a report on a bunch of black, unmarked government vehicles surrounding my team at gunpoint. and pulling us and illegally searching our vehicle and taking passport numbers, interrogating us. So this stuff does happen, and journalists need to be protected. So learn about security by using a hashtag. Particularly when I got started, I would be on Twitter with only a few hundred followers, and I would tweet live broadcast, you know, live now at hashtag OWS. So everyone who's on Twitter can see the hashtag OWS, click it, and then when they go to search all these feeds, they see my link. And that's what drove traffic to my live video. You can do similar things with Facebook, but it's you know, it really comes down to understanding social media and a lot of grunt work. But you know, building an audience is a very, very complicated discussion, probably for an entire, you know, 3 or 4 hour, probably a class, you know, it's gonna take you 6 months. But I would say that the best things you can do right now, sign up for Twitter, probably already have, it's an amazing newswire. Use Facebook, use Google+, and just get out through social media as much as possible, and make sure you're using tags so that people can find your content. Just any way you can make it easy to find. It's really, I would say right off the bat, Twitter is your go-to shot. There can be, there are many, many cases over the past year with the major protest movements that, you know, happened around the world, where individuals who went out with nothing but a cell phone tweeted, so, you know, streaming live the Denver protest, and they would hashtag Denver and hashtag Occupy, and it would just instantly go viral because the community is watching, you know, things they care about. These people would go from it would be their first broadcast, and they would instantly have 30,000 viewers just through a wire like Twitter. Twitter also has another service called Vine that just came out recently, which allows you to do 6-second videos, and that is also very, very amazing. So you can actually shoot a 6-second video and then put going live now with like a preview. For media, I have a donation page, and I do a pay what you will model. I have been approached by companies that offer paywall services, which makes sense in some instances, but you know, when I'm doing live breaking news, it's you don't want to do that. It doesn't make sense, and you can't run ads on it. So depending on the size of the event, people give, and they give more than you can charge them for. If the average person would pay $2 to watch breaking news, that person will probably give you $25 just to help you continue doing your work, because we've seen this model with like Louis C.K., a comedian put out his work and said, "If you guys really, I really appreciate it if you just give me $5 for it." And he ended up making millions. So that's my monetization model. It's very difficult, but I do sell footage every so often, and I do get asked for the rights to my live broadcast by television networks and websites.